It's a beautiful day out there, but you wouldn't know from the drawn blinds. But we're very appreciative that you came to today's event, which promises to be very interesting. Our invited guest is Kimberly Marten, and she is the Ann Whitney Olin Professor of Political Science at Barnard College and a faculty member at Columbia University School of International Public Affairs. She is a very accomplished scholar. Much of her work has been on Russian foreign and defense policy, Russian informal politics, patronage networks. She has written two books on Russia, but she has written on broader themes as well. Her most recent book is on warlords, and it is entitled Warlords, Strong Arm Brokers and Weak States, and it's a book that looks at the phenomenon of warlords in a number of different places, including the tribal areas of Pakistan, in the Sunni Arab areas of Iraq. So her expertise is relevant to a number of different international issues in the news these days, and in the post-Soviet Georgia and the Republic of Chechnya in Russia. And she also has a book on enforcing peace, which is a book that I very much appreciated as well. You may have seen her in other settings. She is a frequent analyst on American media, including major networks. But I have to say that that what I most appreciated, and I have to admit to being somewhat envious, was her appearance on the Daily Show with Jon Stewart, which I was extremely impressed, and I can't imagine how nervous that she must have been prior to going on that show. Who knows what Jon Stewart is going to say? But she did a superb job. And in any event, we have somebody here who really has a tremendous amount of academic excellence and background, and also who is used to speaking to diverse groups on subjects of current interest, including that of Russia, and that's the subject of today's talk, Russia, Ukraine, and the West. So please join me in welcoming Kimberly Marten.
Thank you, Roland, for that very kind introduction, and thank you for inviting me here today, and thank you to all of you for taking some time on this beautiful day to share your time with me. As we were getting started over here, my friend and colleague Steve Sademan said, "So, what's the answer? How do you dance with a wounded bear?" And of course, the obvious answer is very carefully. What's the takeaway that I'm going to be talking about today? Putin rules through informal personal networks, and I'll explain what the implications of that are. Anti-Western nationalism is something that makes him stronger. Neither of those things is unique to Putin. They have been true throughout the last several hundred years of Russian history. Sanctions might backfire as a result of that combination, and I'll explain why that is the case. It's pretty clear to me that people put on the sanctions believing that they were going to harm those personal networks of Putin, but the fact that those networks benefit from anti-Westernism means that it might actually be driving the network closer together. And all of us, the United States, Canada, and NATO, have to deal with Russia as it truly is, not as we would wish it to be. And that means that when dancing with a wounded bear, we have to remember it's a bear, we have to remember that it's wounded, but we have to remember that we have to dance with the bear too. So, let me start off by talking about Putin as an individual. He is unpredictable. Why is he unpredictable? Well, first, obviously, he is a former KGB man. He spent the first half of his career in the KGB, working his way up the ranks, and he began his time at the national level in Russian politics by being the head of the FSB, the follow-on organization to the KGB. And that means that he is a real expert in masking and deception. It's something that he's been doing for his entire career, and it's something that he obviously enjoys doing. You can just see it in his eyes when he manages to pull one over on somebody else, how much pleasure he gets out of that fact. Also, he's a judo master, not a chess master. Sometimes we, at least in the United States, I assume it's true in Canada too, have this stereotype of Russians that say, oh, they're all good chess players. And so people ask me all the time, what is Putin's end game? Well, that implies that he has an end game. I don't think that Putin has an end game. I don't think he's playing chess. I think what he's doing is going into rounds of judo. So how does somebody who's a judo master approach things? Well, they look at the opponent, they go into the room and they look at the opponent and they size the opponent up and they say, what do I see about that opponent's weaknesses? And once they found the weaknesses, the next question is, how can I make that opponent fall from his own weight? And if you succeed in that round, you knock the guy over, he's on the ground, you go on to the next round. You don't think too much about what's already happened, you just look at the next opponent and size him up again. And if you lose one round, so what? You got a whole bunch of other rounds ahead of you. So it's a very tactical way of looking at the world, and I think we can see that Putin uses this kind of tactical decision making in everything that he does. He tries everything out to see if he can find a weakness in his opponents. So what can we predict about Putin? He does pursue broad goals, and we know what his broad goals are. He wants to stay in power. I'll say more about that in a second. And he wants to expand Russia's power and prestige. And in fact, I would go even further at this point in his career and say that he sees his purpose in history as being expanding Russia's power and prestige. But if you think about that, both of those things, maintaining power at home and expanding Russia's power and prestige, can be pursued through lots of different paths. And I think he goes after these goals without having long-term strategies. So a question that always gets asked is, so is Putin going to stop now that he's got these warlords operating in eastern Ukraine, or is Putin going to go for the rest of Ukraine? And my answer to that would be, Putin may not even know himself. He will try various things, he will take various tactical decisions, and he will see what works. Obviously, he'd rather have more than less, but if it doesn't work, he'll stop with less and still be satisfied and try his tactics somewhere else. So his decisions are tactical, they're opportunistic, and they're reactive. And I think we've seen what that means for NATO over the past few weeks. It means that we have to constantly be on our guard because Russia is not our friend. Putin has a very strong desire to try to take actions that end up sort of niggling away at NATO interests anywhere that he can. So it makes it very difficult when he's not just making military threats, but he's doing things, for example, like you may have all read about the Estonian intelligence officer who was kidnapped at the Estonian border. Russia believes that he was kidnapped in Russian territory, but Russia is basically the only country that believes that. Everybody else believes that he was kidnapped on the Estonian side of the border because that's what all the evidence points to. But how do you react to that? That's our challenge. If he's just going to take these little tactical maneuvers to test us out and to see where our weakness or our strength is, that makes things very difficult. Now, in addition to Putin being unpredictable, the Russian system makes all political decisions unpredictable. Why is that? It's because decisions are made by very unclear, opaque networks. We have a pretty good idea of who Putin's friends are, but that doesn't mean that we know who is participating in each individual decision making that goes on. And so we don't really know who the individuals were who were taking part in Putin's deliberations about what to do in Crimea or what to do in eastern Ukraine. It's just a matter of guesswork. The rumors are that he doesn't even go into the Kremlin anymore. He conducts all of his work at his dacha outside of Moscow, closer to St. Petersburg, and this is how things work. So decisions are not made by hierarchies or institutions. Decisions are not made by the foreign ministry or the defense ministry or by consultations with leaders in the Russian Duma. It's Putin and a close group of associates who may vary from time to time, who have power because of their personal association with him, not because of the position that they hold. In fact, some of these people that he consults with are not holding government positions, and we don't really understand exactly who influences what decision. So this is a photograph of Putin's supporters being out on the street. He certainly is a populist. He's somebody who is very, very good at getting public opinion on his side, but he only needs the public to cement his private authority because it's this very small group of decision makers that matter. It's not the public that matters. We've seen over the last couple of years that Putin is very capable of manipulating election results. He can do this by encouraging encouraging particular people not to run by basically threatening them if they decide to keep on running. He can do it by choosing which candidates get money for media appearances and which just can't get on any kind of media sources to save their lives. So he can manipulate the elections, and it's not that he needs the support of the public to be reelected, it's that he needs to be reelected with broad public support in order to maintain his power in this private network that really makes all of the decisions. Now, keep in mind, this isn't new. This is something that existed way back in Imperial Russian history. And there are a couple of scholars who've written about this. Edward Keenan pointed out that the system of political clan competition really went back to the founding of the Russian state under Ivan the Great centuries ago. It's always been the case that small groups of nobility, at one point it was family members, now it appears to be family members again. During the Soviet period, it may not have been family so much as it was other ways of defining clan, but there have always been groups competing against each other to get the attention of the Tsar and to try to think about ways to get around the Tsar, and if the Tsar doesn't serve their interest, to overthrow the Tsar. So this isn't a new system. And Jeffrey Hosking pointed out that it really is rooted in the culture of the Mongol occupation. Why do I say that? Well, we have to go back to Kievan Rus to think about what the Mongol occupation meant. Originally, both the Russian and the Ukrainian cultures were based in the area of Kiev with an ethnic group that was referred to as the Rus. And before the Mongols came, we think we know that the way decisions were made in this region was the same way that decisions are made amongst a lot of tribal groups all over the world. That probably is sort of the root of how political decisions were made by most of humanity throughout most of civilization. And that is that it was relatively democratic. It probably didn't include women. But among the men, it was relatively democratic at the village or the neighborhood level. And even the person who was in charge would go consult with these councils before making decisions. And so there was the sense that the person in charge still represented what popular opinion was. What changed with the Mongols? The Mongols came in and paid people to be on their side. And so the Mongols really operated in a way that classic empires operated again in the 19th century and the early 20th century of through indirect rule, of paying people off in return for their loyalty and in return for favoritism. And Hosking makes the argument that that culture is what really has had an impact on Russian politics and Russian policymaking ever since the time of the Mongols. It certainly existed in Soviet times as well. There's a brilliant new book by Arch Getty of the University of California at Los Angeles that just came out this past year that goes into great detail using archives located in Russia in showing how Stalin used this same form of clan competition even within the security services, the NKVD, the predecessor to the KGB, to try to cement his own power by getting people to fight against each other. And Getty's argument is that actually a lot of the horrible violence that happened in the Stalin era was done for this petty kind of politicking that went on between these various clan groupings. And other scholars like T.H. Rigby have talked about how this is exactly how the Soviet bureaucracy worked under Brezhnev as well. So nothing is new, and even though we tend to see the Bolshevik Revolution and the Soviet period as being this sea change in how things operated in Russia, you can make an argument that the system of politics was still relatively similar in terms of informal politics, who you knew was how you got ahead, that it was still based on clans, whether those clans were from family members or from workplaces or from localities and neighborhoods, and that it's really been this whole system all the way along of clans competing against each other for control at the top. Oops, made a mistake there. Let's see, how do I get back? Huh. I do this. Thank you. There we go. So, given that all this informal network politics stuff happens at a very closed level, what kind of predictions can we make about informal network decision making? Well, we know that all leaders have to continually signal their strength. And one of the recent scholars who's written about this a lot is Henry Hale, who has a new book out about the whole former Soviet space, talking about the importance of leaders always demonstrating to their followers how strong they are. So that's where we get the notion that the public politics matters in Russia, but it matters primarily in terms of how it influences what this small group thinks about Putin's capabilities. So we have Putin riding bareback on a horse. We have Putin shooting a gun. We have Putin taming a tiger. And then just to make sure the message gets across, we have Putin bare-chested with a gun that's used to send a tranquilizer dart into a tiger. So Putin signals on a regular basis how strong he is. And we in the West have sometimes tended to laugh at these things. I know John Stewart has laughed at these things about Putin being bare-chested and what that means for his own insecurities. But keep in mind that the insecurities are primarily about how Putin appears to his close network associates. And Putin is starting to get old, especially in Russian terms. He's getting old for Russian men. Russian men don't have a tendency to live that long. And so he has to constantly broadcast to everybody that he's still strong and that he's still in power. I believe that means that Putin will never, never, never be seen as giving in to the West. And that's something that we should consider when we're thinking about what to do towards Russia. Putin will never be seen to capitulate. The only time that Putin will cooperate is if it looks like he's making a creative decision to solve a problem that the West couldn't think of. And one example of that was the September surprise last year when Putin came up with the way of getting the chemical weapons out of Syria. He did it to prevent Obama from leading airstrikes. And so he did it for reasons that were, you know, helping his own network connections. But it really did help the United States. It really did help the Western community a whole heck of a lot to get those chemical weapons out of Syria. And Putin did that. He did something that was essentially cooperating with the West, but he did it in a backhanded way that made himself look like he was the one who could pull the rabbit out of the hat and pull one over on Obama. Everyone remembers Gorbachev. Now, in the West, we think of Gorbachev as being a hero. Gorbachev was who ended the Cold War. In Russia, he is seen as weak. He was the one who cost the Soviet Union all of its territory. And by some, he's seen as being a traitor. He was the one who capitulated unilaterally. He gave in and NATO expanded. And so Putin does not want to be Gorbachev. That would be the worst thing for Putin. What else can we predict about informal network decision making? All interactions are heavily personalized. Well, we've talked about that in Russia, but I think it applies to foreign policy too. So we had Putin dealing with the former president of Georgia, Mikhail Saakashvili. The interaction between those two men often looked like a soap opera. And what was the most interesting at the end of Saakashvili's time in power was that Putin refused to have any diplomatic engagement with Georgia so long as Saakashvili was president. Talk about a personalized approach to foreign policy. And then there's Mike McFaul, the former U.S. ambassador to Russia. He was actually hanging around Stanford when I was in graduate school, so I've known Mike for decades. And he was picked on in Russia in a way that was just incredible. And his family was picked on. And you just don't expect people to do that for somebody who is an ambassador. The ambassador is supposed to be somebody who's treated with respect no matter what's going on in the country. Well, part of the reason that they treated Mike McFaul that way was certainly that his academic writings talked about the desirability of having democracy in Russia. So Putin would have thought of that as being threatening. But I think it goes beyond that. When he was doing his dissertation work and when he was working in Russia earlier on as an academic, McFaul got to know a lot of the people who were in Yeltsin's network, including people that Putin got rid of during the time that Putin came to power in the early 2000s, including people who were in Yeltsin's KGB and FSB, which means that McFaul knows people who know where the bodies are buried. And, you know, on top of everything else, that means that McFaul is a little bit of a something that somebody like Putin might be a little bit wary of just because of his knowledge base. All foreign actors are going to be seen through this patron-client prism. And for evidence of that, I really recommend a book that came out last year by the journalist Peter Baker on called Days of Fire, Bush and Cheney in the White House. And he has several really funny examples of how Putin acted towards Bush in a way that implied that Putin believed that Bush also had this informal politics system in place. So one example was that Bush had a campaign friend that he was talking about who came from the oil industry, and Putin said to him, "Oh, would it be helpful to you if I gave this man a position in one of our big oil companies?" Another example was that Bush was talking about how, you know, his term was going to come to an end at some point, and he had to think about what it meant. And Putin said, "So why can't you just change change the Constitution and run for a third term. Yet another example, you may remember that Dan Rather, who was the anchor of CBS News in the United States, got fired or encouraged to leave his position after there was some reporting that turned out to be based on false, made-up resources about what Bush had done in terms of his National Guard service. And Putin actually talked to Bush, saying that Putin understood that Bush had been able to fire Dan Rather. And, you know, CBS is a private company that is, it's not a company that is a U.S. government-owned agency. Bush had nothing to do with whether Dan Rather stayed on at CBS or not. But Putin believed that Bush had the same kind of capabilities in the United States that Putin had in Russia. What other predictions can we make? Well, leaders have an incentive to appear aggressive, but to act cautiously. Why is this? It's because if you are trying to keep the interests of your network in mind, the biggest mistake would be to cause a terrible loss to that network that they can't recover from. So if you are somebody like Putin, you want to speak loudly, but realize that you're carrying a relatively small stick. Most important is avoiding major losses. Now, everyone remembers Nikita Khrushchev and the Cuban Missile Crisis, right? What happened was that Khrushchev put missiles in Cuba, thought he was going to get away with it, thought he could do it without the United States and the Western Hemisphere noticing. What happened instead is that he got forced to pull back those missiles because Kennedy figured it out, launched a blockade of Cuba, brought world attention to what was happening, and made Khrushchev look not so good. And this fit other things that Khrushchev did during his time in power, taking very sudden decisions that had negative consequences without really thinking about those consequences in advance. And what happened a couple years after the Cuban Missile Crisis is that Khrushchev was gently escorted out of office by a group of Communist Party members who cooperated with the Soviet military to get rid of him and allow him to retire nicely for the rest of his life. So Putin doesn't want to end up like Khrushchev ended up. He doesn't want people to think he made stupid mistakes that actually ended up hurting the country and hurting their interests. So I think that leads to the question of whether Putin miscalculated in Ukraine. And I think you can make arguments on both sides. You could say that Putin never expected the Western coalition to hold together as well as it did. He didn't expect that the sanctions would have the incredible impact on the Russian economy that they are having. Or, as I'll argue in a few moments, you could argue that actually Putin calculated very, very carefully. He made sure that he took Crimea in a way that didn't really count as a military invasion, so people couldn't look at it as being a military invasion. He made very, very careful moves in the eastern part of Ukraine. The Russian forces were snuck in over the border when nobody was really paying attention, when their attention was diverted by what was happening with the humanitarian aid delivery that was coming from Russia. And in fact, I'll argue that I don't think the sanctions are going to work over the long term. And so maybe Putin calculated very well. He got more territory without actually having to bear very big losses for what he did. But I mean, that's something to discuss and see if we all agree on that. What else can we predict? Policies can appear static, but then they're going to shift dramatically without any warning. And that's just because they're made in this very small group setting, and so you don't get any indicators that a change is happening. There's no public discussion. There's no gathering of opinion. There's no official meetings that happen. It's just that all of a sudden a policy shifts. And I think the classic example of that was the September surprise last year over Syria, out of getting the chemical weapons out. Up until that point, Putin had not said anything about the United Nations Security Council. He didn't want them intervening in Syria. And all of a sudden, the policy shifted, and the UN Security Council went in as being the body that was overseeing what was happening with the chemical weapons removal. But I think we can see that in Ukraine, too. And keep in mind that this really distinguishes the Russian system both from institutionalized systems, systems like Canada, like the United States, where everything is worked out according to procedures and according to laws. But it's also very different from an ideology-based system, because in an ideology-based system, you can predict based on what the ideology says what's going to come next. And I don't think in Russia you can do that. One thing to keep in mind is that we've got two different versions of Putin. Putin 1 was very measured. Putin 2 has been much more of a nationalist extremist, and I'll talk about that in a moment. And then the September surprise that I keep on coming back to. So, who does Putin use as his personal networks? Contacts from his time working for the mayor's office in St. Petersburg, former KGB and current FSB officers who are sprinkled throughout business and throughout a variety of other government agencies, and increasingly nationalist idealists, some of whom come from the top hierarchy of the Russian Orthodox Church, from the Moscow Patriarchate, and some of which are based in the Eurasianist movement. I'm not going to take the time to go through all these in detail, but I have some examples, if anybody's interested in Q&A, of how you can explain a lot of Putin's major decision-making. For example, his stress on building civilian nuclear power plants in Iran as being things that actually completely serve the interests of his personal network. So the two big Soviet Russian enterprises that are responsible for building the Bushehr power plant in Iran and that will build any more civilian nuclear reactors in Iran that Russia does. Both of them are based in St. Petersburg, so it's got that St. Petersburg connection that Putin had from his time in the mayor's office. And in fact, the man who runs or has significant shares in both of those companies is the man who ran Putin's 2004 presidential election campaign. In addition, the people who make the decisions about managing the contracts are people who come from the former KGB and the FSB. And let me just say that the major way that many people in Putin's network make their money is not through the profits that are gained by the enterprises, because many of the enterprises are state-owned. It's because they control who gets the contracts that those enterprises are involved with, and that means they have the opportunity, perhaps, to take a cut off the top when a contract is signed. Other examples are the people involved in Russian defense weapons exports, all very closely connected to Putin in various ways, including through the old KGB. The man who's in charge of the weapons export agency is the man who lived in Putin's apartment building in Dresden when Putin was a KGB operative living in East Germany. And the Almazante Corporation, which is the one that makes all of the various kinds of air defense systems, is also very closely connected to the KGB and to Putin's prior employment history. And so all of these things that seem to be being done on behalf of Russian national interests are also things that benefit Putin's personal network very, very tightly. Now, you can tell from these examples that I gave that this is what the Western sanctions are designed to be going against. Almazante, the big air defense systems corporation, is one of the targets of the sanctions. A lot of the individuals on that list who are Putin's network connections are targets of the sanctions. And so you might think to yourself, and I've really struggled with this myself, that maybe they're very well targeted, because maybe what the sanctions are trying to do is to take away the ability of Putin to give his network members money. What they're doing is they're making Putin look weak because he can't give them the opportunity for new contracts. Well, let's think about this for a moment. It's not clear what Russia is supposed to do to end the sanctions, and so they can come and go at will without necessarily being responsive to Russian actions, which means that the sanctions have this inherently political connotation to them that responds to domestic political situations as much as it does to Russian actions, because if President Obama decides for domestic reasons to change a particular sanction policy, he can always find something that indicates that Russia is moving in a direction that indicates that now is the time to take the sanction off. And I would just remind everybody that on September 30th, there's supposed to be a big review of sanctions policy in the EU, and I believe in Canada as well. I think Canada is also taking part in that. You know, there's all kinds of things happening. There's the ceasefire happening in Ukraine that could give people a reason for lifting some of the sanctions, if in fact the sanctions are really being lifted because of domestic political pressure at home. They also impede useful transnational connections, and we can talk more about this in Q&A, but one of the things that's most disturbing to me is that there's no military-to-military conversations going on right now between Russia and the United States. So we've got this situation where there are all these harassing moves that are being taken by Russian military aircraft against NATO installations and NATO facilities and into NATO airspaces. You know, at the very highest level, there may be ways for people at the very top to talk about these things. But one thing that happened during the Cold War, during the height of the Cold War, is there were these ongoing meetings about dangerous military activities, about something called incidents at sea. So when Soviet and NATO military equipment, transport, got into tight situations, they came up with agreed rules for how they would act so as not to make the crisis explode. And I think this is the kind of time when we need military-to-military activities. But I've heard from some U.S. military officers that the Obama administration has actively discouraged them from pursuing these kinds of activities because it's part of the sanctions regime. They target income more than wealth. As I mentioned, a lot of these people make their money by contracts. Their wealth is stored far offshore, and that is not being affected by the sanctions. So it's their ability to get more income on a daily basis that the sanctions are affecting. But if you believe that the sanctions aren't going to last long term, then you're probably less concerned about the way that the wealth is being, that the income is being affected. Because to work, sanctions have to be maintained over a long period by a unified international community. And I'm not sure that the West is capable of either of those things. And I believe that Putin probably knows that it's very unlikely that the West is capable of either of those things. It's not also clear what their political goals are. Is it to get Putin's coalition to convince him to change? Is it to try to drive Putin's coalition away from him? Is it trying to induce regime change? What is supposed to be the pressure on Putin? That's not clear either. Well, let's assume that the goal is somehow getting Putin's network to rebel against him. The problem is that Russia faces what political scientists call a collective action problem. Even if people share a goal, it's always hard in any circumstance to get a group of people to work together to get that goal met, especially in the absence of one particular group leader. So, is there a clear network leader alternative to Putin? Is there somebody in the Russian hierarchy who would step in to take Putin's place and who therefore would be capable of getting this group of people to come together to act against Putin? I don't know of one. Now, maybe our intelligence agencies do know of one and they're just not telling us, but I think it's really kind of a guessing game about what would happen if Putin were suddenly to be assassinated tomorrow or were to drop dead of a heart attack. Who would take over in Russia? It isn't clear. It isn't clear that there's a clear person to lead this coalition that would be moving against Putin. The other question that makes the Russian situation even more difficult than collective action situations elsewhere is that the prime members of Putin's network are KGB operatives. That means that they have techniques that they can use that other people can't use against each other. So it's already hard for a group to act together. Is any individual in that group going to be willing to take action if they understand that the consequences of taking that action and miscalculating might be that they completely destroy their career? Because one of the things that the KGB, the FSB, is very good at is what's called kompromat, releasing compromising material about somebody that either gets them arrested, because nobody could make money in early Russia without breaking some laws, and so you can always arrest people on those laws from then, or finding a family member even who has done something that the person doesn't want revealed and plastering it on the front pages of the newspaper to shame the person, so that implicit threat is always behind anybody breaking away out of this tight group that's surrounding Putin. So the question is, are the costs of the sanctions sufficient to overcome the fear of change? And I would argue that because there's not a lot of high probability that the West is going to stick together in its sanctions, and because the sanctions are affecting income more than they're affecting wealth, everybody knows that their wealth is stored offshore. They can still go get their billions of dollars or even their hundreds of millions of dollars, even if their immediate income is being taken away from them. You have to ask, are the costs of the sanctions and their understanding of what the sanctions actually involve, are they sufficient to overcome this fear of change, to be the one who steps out and goes against everybody else to say, Putin, it's time to go? Now, maybe they are, but I don't think we're there yet, and I think it would take a lot stronger action on behalf of a lot more unified international community, not just the West, but China, in order to get Russia to decide that it had no alternatives, and people to think that therefore Putin had to go and they were willing to take the risk of acting against Putin. The other thing we don't know is whether the networks still are what we think they are. I mentioned that Putin 1 and Putin 2 are very different from each other. Putin went through some drastic changes after 2012. Is it possible that what he's doing is not going for his own beliefs and ideas, but actually responding to a nationalist shift inside his own coalition? And in that case, are sanctions just going to strengthen that coalition because anti-Western nationalism is what it feeds off of? So let me just go quickly thinking about Russian nationalism. The common view is that it's the fault of the West. If only NATO hadn't expanded, then Russia wouldn't feel so threatened by what's happening in the West right now. That's actually the core of the new project that I'm pursuing. I'm going to look at the question of what would have happened if NATO hadn't expanded. But I'm going to argue that just like it's not new that the political system in Russia is the way that it is, it's not new that there's anti-Western nationalism in Russia. That's been true throughout history, throughout imperial times, and throughout Soviet times. And it actually makes the networks stronger. It allows them to justify their crackdown on traitors. One of the things that is most disturbing about what's happening in Russia these days is that anybody, especially anybody in the intelligentsia who is criticizing Putin, is now being put on a national list of traitors. And you may have heard about the march that happened in Moscow on Sunday, where something like 26,000 people marched against Putin's actions in Ukraine. When they got to the end of their march, there was a long banner hanging on the building that the march ended at that listed by name all of the so-called traitors, the members of the intelligentsia, the member of the arts community that had gone against Putin. Now, so far, those people aren't being punished except to be identified. They're being harassed by having television programs that say bad things about them. But it's looking more and more like we're moving back to a very close political system. And I would just ask us to remember George F. Kennan, the great diplomat from the United States in Soviet times, his original view of what containment policy was supposed to be. If you take away an enemy, a despotic regime is going to fall from its own weight. Because by having an enemy to feed off of, that gives it an excuse for having a closed system, it gives it an excuse to identify enemies within its own regime, and it gives it an excuse for the need for authoritarianism. So I could go on at length, but I know I'm running out of time. I can speak more in Q&A about nationalism that's been growing in Russia. And I would just close by saying that we need to think about containment for a new era. What does containment for a new era mean? It means making very clear to Putin that the small tactical decisions that he's making do have real answers. We have to think of a way of answering Putin without going towards military confrontation. And I don't know what the answer is, but it does mean acting. It doesn't mean sitting back and saying we don't want to provoke Russia, because if we sit back and do nothing, Putin will take it as a sign of weakness. But it does mean that we should expect more of this to come, and it's going to take some creative thinking to figure out what to do next. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. Wow. Wow, what a tour de force. Given us a tremendous amount to think about, and provocative. And I'm sure there are going to be a ton of questions. So what I'm going to do now is call questions for you, if that's all right. And I'll just remind everybody of our house rules, which are if you ask a question, please identify yourself. Please wait for the microphone to get to you, since we want to record the session. And also, please keep your question, your comment short. No big, long speeches, please. So we'll start here with Steve. If somebody can bring a microphone forward, please. Oh, this one.
It's right there. Excellent talk. That was really fascinating. Helped me, a real good cheat sheet for what we've been trying to figure out for Putin the past year or so. I'm Steve Sabin from Carleton University. And the question I have is, I've heard rumors that in the run-up to this, that Putin was encouraging the oligarchs closest to him to divest themselves from the West, because that way the sanctions that would happen would not really affect them. Now, given that the particular crisis point, which was Ukraine, which was not something he really anticipated, was there this kind of long-term planning to try to wean those folks from the West?
That's a really good question, and I would say that the answer is probably yes. And I should have published it, but I didn't. I actually made the prediction back in January, at the time that the Sochi Olympics were starting to come on the screen, that this was going to be a difficult year for Russian-Western relations. I certainly didn't predict that it was going to be over Ukraine, and I didn't predict what it was going to be about. The reason is that the Sochi Olympics were built on the back of a huge amount of corruption. And the person who runs the Russian Railways Company, which is a state-owned company named Vladimir Yakunin, was also the person who controlled all of the contracts for transportation in and out of Sochi, both on the railroads and on the highways. Sochi is located in an out-of-the-way area, and so it wasn't already on a major transportation route, so new highways had to be built, improvement of the rail structure had to happen, and that means that all of the construction materials for what went into making those buildings for the Sochi Olympics had to be trucked over these highways and over these rail lines that Yakunin controlled. There were rumors happening last fall, in the fall of 2013, that after the Sochi Olympics closed, there was going to be a reckoning. Because remember, the people that supported Putin in past years were a combination of folks. It wasn't just the KGB people. It wasn't just the St. Petersburg people. It was also people who were really mainstream economists who believed that Putin's very rational, very straightforward decision-making was doing things that were good for the country. Putin did a very nice job of building up this emergency fund, the sovereign wealth fund, from oil and gas exports that would be there to take care of things that happened. He balanced the Russian budget. He improved the taxation system. So lots of economists favored him. But lots of economists were getting very angry about the level of corruption in Russian society. And one of those economists came and spoke at the Harriman Institute at Columbia. His name is Sergei Gordiev. And he was a very prominent Russian economist who now feels a need. He has relocated himself to Paris because he is so concerned about the consequences for staying in Russia. But he argues that the major reason that the Russian economy was starting to falter, and it was starting to falter in January before any of this other stuff happened, was in fact the results of corruption on the economy and the fact that all of these contracts have something cut off over the top of them that is really detracting from Russia's ability to be competitive in its business environment. So I predicted in January, even though I didn't put it in publication, that what would happen is that there would be some kind of Russian anger towards the West that would make nationalism grow and would take everybody's mind off the corruption that was going to become an issue after the Olympics were over. Now, that doesn't mean that I think Putin invaded Ukraine and did everything else he did just to take people's minds off the corruption, but I think it was very convenient in its timing. Does that answer your question?
Sure.
Okay.
Oh.
You
need to be closer.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. My name is Ferit Kakov, a senior fellow here, and also Bivshe Paslanik Pasolvi Kanadi, Pasolvi Kanadi in Russia from 92 to 94. In May 2012, Russia issued the foreign policy statement that was requested by Putin, written by the foreign ministry, and the anti-Western tone in it was just amazing. And really, my question is, who was the message addressed to? Was it to the West to say we hate you? Was it to reassure, to build some support? It was amazing. Revanchism and all of that was there. So there was a sense that, is that the guy we were dealing with just a few months before? So what's your take on that extraordinary statement?
That's a really good question, and that's one of those examples of the surprises coming out of the system when all of a sudden things seem to be going on an even keel, and then boom, something happens. The one thing that I can say with a high degree of confidence is that it was not something that was invented by the foreign ministry. It's very clear in Russia that the foreign ministry has no power whatsoever. It is just a mouthpiece for the Putin coalition. And Sergei Lavrov is very good at, you know, responding to whatever signals he gets at whatever moment. He's a survivor. But that's a very good question. I would guess, knowing what we know now, that it probably was something that was a message to this internal network, whether it was a message that, yes, I'm going to move in this direction that you're pushing me, or, yes, this is the direction that we're moving, just so everybody's clear on what's going to happen and prepare yourself for it. I don't know what the answer is, but that's his audience. So it probably had effects on the public as well, but the public effects were mostly in order to bolster his opinion within this private network audience. That's a good question.
gentleman in the I'm taking a list, and you'll okay. be next. You'll be next.
Right. Sorry, excuse me. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. My name is Vasily Guldish. I'm the third secretary of the Russian embassy here. So, thank you for your presentation.
To say Putin and not Russia. The whole time that I was talking, I don't blame Russia for anything. I blame Putin for everything.
Still, may I ask a question? So, I really appreciate your remark concerning inter-agency communications between the Western countries and Russia, and we believe the same actually. But, and returning to the McFaul situation, I personally met him several times in Moscow. He wasn't not at all as isolated, actually, in terms of our Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And the question is it now a retaliation from the Canadian government? We have no contact in the ministry, in foreign ministry here. And though in the times of Mr. McFaul, there was no limit for him to come into ministry and speaking to deputy minister and so on.
That's really interesting.
Thank you.
I wasn't aware of that. That makes me sad that that's happening. I think that's just perhaps another example of the cutoff in relations. And I would just remind everybody that during the Cold War, when everything was at the height, that was not what happened. It's really important to keep channels of communication open so that we know what each other is thinking, even when we drastically disagree with what each other is thinking. I was very happy that yesterday, just before I came here, we were able to have the director of IMAMO, the top international relations study institute in Moscow, come and speak at Columbia. And I think that that kind of scholarly exchange is important. I think that diplomatic exchanges are important. I think student exchange programs are important. I think military exchange programs are important. And that doesn't mean that necessarily the other side is always going to agree. I mean, with military to military programs, they had been really quiet because the Russians had not been agreeing to participate in any of the things that the US and Canada and NATO had been proposing in recent years, but they were there, and that sent a message that said that we are open to hearing your perspective on things. And if the diplomatic relations are also being shut down, I think that's sad. And I can understand the desire of people to punish Russia. I think what Russia did in Ukraine was terrible. But punishing isn't necessarily something that has good results in terms of accomplishments.
Sir, can I just hand you?
Douglas Clayton, I'm a professor emeritus of Russian studies here.
Okay.
And I'd like to comment on your metaphors.
Okay.
The first metaphor is dancing with a bear, a wounded bear. The question is, why is the bear wounded? The second question is, who is the bear dancing with? Who is the bear dancing with?
Oh, okay.
And then you switch metaphors, you start talking about jujitsu, or is it judo, whatever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. I always tell my students, you're in the Kremlin. What does the world look like? And from the Kremlin perspective, they see a United States, and I would not include myself in your we, by the way, a United States which goes around trying to change regimes, and that was an important part of your statement also. How do you deal, and by the way, in changing regimes, inevitably they break up the country and create civil war. Whether it is in Libya, whether it's in Iraq, whether it's in Syria, and now in the Ukraine, you have civil war after civil war. This is their opponent. This is a very aggressive opponent, and someone who, a professor, a very important professor, goes around saying, we need to change the regime, we need to get rid of Putin.
I suggested that that was the cause of the sanctions.
Okay.
I did not suggest that that was a good idea.
Okay. You don't think it's a good idea.
I did not say anything about my own politics except to criticize the sanctions regime.
Do you agree with the policy of regime change?
No.
Okay. Good. I'm glad to hear you.
Over the past decade, that it doesn't work.
It doesn't work.
We can get rid of existing regimes, but we're not very good at figuring out what replaces.
Anyway,
them.
My question had to do with regime change. Should we simply leave Russia alone and allow Russia to develop, and in the fullness of time, Russia will develop a much more broader set of relationships and in fact will become much more of a civilized country.
So let me answer all of your various questions in turn. I think you answered your own question about what makes Russia wounded. It's the perception that it has been harmed terribly by actions of the United States and NATO, including through NATO expansion, including through the United States and NATO deciding to use force over the Kosovo conflict without getting UN Security Council approval, over the decision of the United States and its coalition allies to go into Iraq without UN Security Council approval, in the way that the Libya mission was changed from what Russia thought it was allowing to happen when it abstained from that UN Security Council resolution that allowed force to be used. So I'm not going to take a position on whether what the United States did was right or wrong, because that's not my purpose here today. My purpose here today is to talk about how Russia thinks about things, and that's where the woundedness comes from, that Russia would like to be a great power that is taken seriously in the international system, and it feels that ever since the beginning of the Yeltsin regime, probably dating back to the end of the Gorbachev regime, the West has taken advantage of it. So that's the wounded part. And one of my points is that this isn't new, that this kind of feeling of being wounded by the West goes back in history. It was how people felt when Peter the Great decided to adopt Western cultural norms, that he was denigrating what was good about Russia. It was, I have in my notes, and I'd have to go back to look at the name of the author again, but an author who, Orlando Figes, who wrote about the Crimean War, what he really made clear is that for Britain and France, the Crimean War was a result of Russophobia in part. And how did the Russian Tsar interpret things? He interpreted it as that Britain and France were going back on the agreement that they had about what was supposed to happen with the Ottoman Empire. In Soviet times, you had Stalin being absolutely convinced that the reason that the United States and Great Britain wouldn't open up a second front in Europe and were coming from the south instead was that they wanted the Soviets to exhaust themselves and be destroyed by having to take on the Nazis alone. So the sense of being wounded isn't new. It goes back in history, but that's where the sense of woundedness comes from. In terms of who's doing the dancing, it's us. And whether or not you agree with US policy, if you're here, you're probably a Canadian citizen, and that means you're stuck with whatever the Canadian government does. And so you are dancing with Putin, whether you wish to be or not. Let's see, what else? Oh, and on the judo metaphor, that was chosen quite deliberately because Putin really is a judo master. Judo is so important to Putin that not only has he put his former judo partners in positions of authority in the current Russian government and in current Russian business endeavors, they had a big role to play in the Sochi development for the Olympics, but also during the time that he was president, Putin made a movie about judo in Russia where it was both talking about the history of judo and talking, he demonstrated his favorite judo moves. And so I think there is just no question that when Putin looks out at the world, he sees it in terms of a judo match because judo is who he is. Though I can't imagine President Obama making a movie about basketball.
Woman right here, the gentleman in the white shirt, and then if you want to get a question in, I'll try and get you in roughly the order that I see you. Please.
Thank you very much for your time. My name is Kendra von Ivan. I am a student in a joint JDMA program shared between the University of Ottawa's Faculty of Law and the Norman Patterson School at Carleton University. I was hoping you could expand a little bit more on your views of how the Russia-China relationship is impacting the situation, in particular either through the energy contracts that were signed or through the Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
That's a very good question. And it's very clear that Russia sees China as an alternative to the West right now. Everything, every time that some avenue of Western development gets shut off, Russia turns to China. So the latest news is that they're going to try to turn to the Chinese payment system as a substitute for Visa and MasterCard so that they're not responsible for the Visa and MasterCard situation. What is interesting about this situation, though, is that China is the one that's getting all the benefit from it. And we could see that based on the pipeline deal that was signed about a month or so ago that made all the headlines about the Russia-Chinese pipeline deal that was supposed to be an alternative to more dealings with Western Europe. China said, sure, you need us? Well, that's fine. Here's our price. And Russia, after having, it was not a new pipeline agreement. It had been in the works for a number of years, but this was the first time that Russia said yes. So yes, they are turning to China. I think that a lot of people have questions about how much China can be a complete substitute for the West. China does not have the same kind of engines of technological innovation that the West has. A lot of people have been talking about that in terms of shale oil and shale gas and the difficult energy sources. resources, that, you know, China in one sense does have a lot of shale that they could be, exploiting in various ways. But China lacks the entrepreneurial system and the laws to support entrepreneurship that places like the United States and Canada have. And that's going to be a real limit on how long it takes China to catch up, even if it decides to develop its shale oil and gas resources. So China may not be a perfect substitute for the West, and that might end up slowing Russia down, even if it can find Chinese substitutes for things that it's doing. And the most important thing to keep in mind is that China does not consider Russia an equal. China is very happy to gain a Russian satellite.
My name is Gary Levy. I'm at Carleton. That question was actually exactly my question, relations between Russia and China, so I won't get you to go over that again, except in one point, and that is because you say Mr. Putin deals very much in a personal level, what does he think about China? Because there's been, you know, over the history, quite a complex relationship between the two, but do you have any idea of how he looks at China?
I'm sorry, I have not researched that question. That's an excellent question, and I don't know the answer to it, and I think you've just created my next project for me.
You should ask for royalties. The man at the very back.
Hi, my name is Raymond Farrell. I'm an officer in the Canadian Army. You've identified the current foreign policy of Russia very, very closely with Mr. Putin and his group, and yet you've identified also the origins of that party, of that position, in and Russian revanchism and so on, in the wounded bear, you know, in the breakup of the Soviet Union and humiliations and so on and so on and so on. So my question is, if we look at the post-Soviet period, we begin with a period in which Russian-Western relations seem fairly peaceful, fairly easy. There's some cooperation. There are some moments of conflict as well. And now, all of a sudden, from the Western perspective, all of a sudden, things have changed radically. To what do you ascribe that? It can't be something personal with Mr. Putin, surely. It has to be some more structural change, or am I wrong?
The first thing that I would recommend is Angela Stent's book. I can't remember the title of it off the top of my head, but it came out this year. She is a professor at Georgetown University who runs their Russian Studies Center, and she used to be the person on the National Intelligence Council in the United States responsible for Russia policy. And she has a wonderful book that chronicles exactly what the ups and downs were in the Russian-American relationship in particular, but that applies to the Russia-NATO relationship as well during the entire post-Soviet period. I don't think that those two things are incompatible, that there is an individual in place who is doing a marvelous job of taking advantage of the systemic situation and the idea that the systemic situation was there to be grabbed hold onto. The biggest mystery is why Gorbachev did what he did, because Gorbachev came out of that system too, and yet somehow he seems to have believed that he could ride the wave and truly change it. And when push came to shove, he got rid of the Communist Party as being the bureaucratic overlay of what was controlling things. He did a very good job of playing the network politics when it came to carrying out purges of the party apparatus in order to get more reformers behind him. But he seems to have neglected that important component of keeping your close network supporters on your side and of paying them off. And by the time he left office, he wasn't really very popular with anybody. I don't see the two things that you're identifying, and if you want to put it in social science terms, structure and agency, I don't see them as being at odds with each other. I think we have an agent in Putin who is very good at understanding what the incentive structure is that he is facing. And I think we have an incentive structure that is very much supporting the personal ambitions of Putin. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
I'm going to take the liberty of asking the next question since I don't see any hands. And I'm wondering if I could ask you to elaborate a bit more on what this dance might look like from our perspective, if I can use that metaphor. We're one of the dancing partners.
What do we need Russia for?
What do we need? No, more specifically, because what I heard in your talk was an excellent analysis of the incentive structures that are built into the ruling system in Russia, and then interacting with sanctions, how our sanctions approach might be not very effective. And you also emphasize the importance of maintaining channels of communication open, which makes perfect sense. And you noted that it's also very important not just to roll over, because that would signal weakness. So solve for X. What the heck are we supposed to do?
That's not my job. I'm not the person who's making policy. That's for all of you to come up with. But I would give you one example that, Roland, I spoke to you about in your office before we came up here. And that is that I read somewhere in the Canadian press, and I can't remember where it was, but in the last couple of weeks, there was an article that detailed how Canada had deployed drones to the Arctic and how significant that was, because there had been questions about whether drone technology would work under Arctic conditions. I think Canada deploying drones to the Arctic was a wonderful move that was a very clear demonstration to Russia that Canada is paying attention to the Arctic, that Canadian technology has the ability to make sure that Canadian interests are being met in the Arctic. And Putin, if you try anything on the Arctic, just remember that we're watching you and we're being creative in the way that we're watching you. Now, I don't have an answer to what we do if an intelligence agent is captured on NATO territory. I don't have an answer of what we do if all of a sudden there's an effort to rile up the Latvian population against the Latvian government by picking out people who are native Russians or native Russian speakers and complaining about citizenship rules. I would suggest in that case that maybe the best response is to try to put pressure on Latvia to make its citizenship rules as inclusive as possible, to take away a way for Putin trying to have a method for interceding there. But there's sort of a danger in keeping your enemy too close to you too, and that's what's happening in Hungary these days. A Harriman graduate student named Casey Michael wrote a really good article this past summer about what's happening in the leadership of Hungary. Remember, Hungary is not only an EU member, Hungary is a NATO member. The leadership of Hungary is leaning in a pro-Putin direction. The leadership of Hungary is turning increasingly towards ethnic nationalism, including towards anti-Semitism in some of the things that it's saying and doing. And that's within the tent. And so, you know, there's always this question of how do you balance bringing people into the tent so they can't be picked off versus having people within the tent who may be trying to undermine you from within. And I think that's a real challenge.
Bob. Thank you very much. My name is Bob Haig. I'm a senior fellow. I was in foreign affairs, responsible for Russia for about 3 years, and also the former Canadian ambassador to Hungary. I won't get into Mr. Orban. And if you can figure out Mr. Orban, you've got a better chance there. Perhaps Putin looks easy compared to that. I guess my question is, and I think you've answered parts of it, is where's the beef? How does this put bread on the Russian table? The contrast between Putin 1, Putin 2, I gather Mr. McFaul has written a book on that. And Putin 1, things were going pretty well. You know, every Western country had programs with Russia. Even cheap Canada was investing money on an annual basis. Exchanges, I believe the Americans took in 20,000 Russian students every summer to work. High investment levels going from the West into Russia. And all of a sudden, Putin 2 changes all that. We're now the enemy. And we regard Russia as the enemy in a certain extent. Is the rationale that corruption and he needed to do something to get people's minds off this, is this the way he wants to be remembered, the man that brought Crimea back? Declining population of the man, as you mentioned, one economy state. I mean, where's this all going to get him?
Your guess is as good as mine, and Putin doesn't want anybody to know the answer to that. So we'll keep on guessing, and there's no way to actually even gather evidence on any of those proposals until we have more knowledge of what happens after Putin. I would guess that many of the things that you've talked about are very reasonable. There's so many problems in the Russian economy. It's not just corruption. It is the fact of brain drain. It is the fact of capital outflows. It is the fact of having an economy that is based on natural resources without any driver for independent technological innovation. All of those things were negative things that were associated with Putin's regime that he may very well have wanted to take people's minds off of. It is a way of covering up corruption and changing the story so that you're no longer talking about corruption. You're now talking about, which of course was one of the big issues in the 2011-2012 protests, but you're now talking instead about how much the West is out to get us. So it is certainly going down in history as the man who regained Russian power after Gorbachev and Yeltsin had sacrificed so much of it. So I think all of those things are involved, and we won't know for a very long time which thing actually explains it. Good question.
Last question,
Dan. Okay. Dan Livermore. I'm also a senior fellow and also a former diplomat. I find myself a little uncomfortable with the word containment, in part because when Kennan and others developed containment, the Soviet Union was a clear adversary. I'm not certain that we're supposed to view Russia now as an adversary, nor is it clear that we're supposed to have viewed Russia as an adversary since about 1991. Brought Russia into the G7 as a gesture of partnership, developed programs within NATO precisely to avoid an adversarial relationship, and therefore the idea of a containment strategy seems to me to be working in a completely opposite direction. But I'm wondering about one thing, and that is, to make this a question, the West has changed too. Mm-hmm. Basically in 1950, the West was the United States. If there's one country that Putin understands, it's Germany. Mm-hmm. Where would the Germans stand on a new containment strategy for the West vis-a-vis Putin and Russia?
Those are all good questions, and let me try to disaggregate them. I don't think that containment is opposed to keeping the door open for future partnership, but I think we have sufficient evidence that Putin's intentions against the West are in fact against the West, that if we don't start thinking about containment, we are going to find ourselves in a bad situation. There is no question that Putin wishes to drive wedges between the United States and the West European allies and Canada. There is no question that Putin is starting to take little nibbling bites to say to the West, we're not sure you're actually going to be able to defend the Baltic states. There is no question that Putin is, this didn't start because the United States decided to go get Putin. This started because Putin said to Ukraine, you have a choice. You can either join the West or you can join us, and you can't do both. Putin is the one who has been making the aggressive moves of late, and to talk about the previous gentleman's questions, that's not to mean that I agree with everything the United States did before. I think getting rid of the ABM treaty was the stupidest thing that the United States has done. I think that NATO expansion probably was inevitable, although my new research project will help me understand better whether that's true or not, but I think NATO expansion could have been handled a bit differently. I think that the discussion coming from the Europeans about the European Union and Ukraine could have been handled a bit differently, even if it wasn't preventing Ukraine from cooperating with Russia. Sometimes some of the statements that came out could be interpreted that way. So it's not to say that the West has handled things well, but I think there's no question that Putin is on the warpath. And if you combine that with new evidence about increased military budgets, about preparation, once again, for the kind of large-scale warfare that was being planned for in Soviet times, maybe it's all defensive. And then we get to what political scientists call the security dilemma. How do you look at what your opponent is doing and understand if they're doing it for defensive purposes to defend themselves, or whether they're doing it because of offensive purposes to try to take something that will be against you? I think it would be really naive, and I think it would actually be reckless for the West not to very consider strongly the possibility that Putin is taking these actions to try to take moves against the West. And so that's where the containment comes from. It's making very clear that NATO is staying as NATO is, and that Putin is not going to be able to make NATO fall apart, and that NATO will defend NATO territory and NATO governments, and coming up with creative ways to demonstrate that. But containment is not the end, and that's why it's containment for a new era. We now know from all of the archival research that, in fact, the Soviet Union was not as aggressive as the West had feared that it was, that the Soviets, for most of their history, were also fairly content to stay within existing borders of Soviet influence and Warsaw Pact influence. And so maybe containment then wasn't a good idea either. But remember what Kennan said about containment, which was very different from how containment got implemented. Kennan said containment is not rollback. Kennan said that this is about making sure that this country that has identified the West as being its enemy in its public statements is not able to harm the West and is not able to get more advantage against the West, but instead waiting for this country to recognize that if it continues on its current course of action, it will fall from its own weight. So in this circumstance, I would say it's making very clear to Putin that NATO will stand strong, and making very clear that if he continues this kind of anti-Western rhetoric and anti-Western behavior, that the West is not going to sit by and be a patsy and allow him to gain strength. But that doesn't mean that we're not open to the possibility of change and that we say that partnership is impossible in certain issues. So it looks like you want to answer that.
The problem I have is that this has been a dialogue of the deaf for almost two decades. You've had NATO and EU expansion into countries that have had no business being EU members or NATO members. They had no qualifications for the job. And the Russians can look at these situations and say, this is encroachment on our former territories. Now, we have answers to all of those things, but the difficulty is that we've lacked engagement with Russia for so long on so many files that if they have suspicions about Western intentions, I don't doubt that they could marshal fairly legitimate arguments to convince their populations that they're true. And my argument now would be the exact wrong direction to go into is to say we need to contain Russia for a new era. That's exactly, to me, the wrong thing to do. What we should do, and you've said it, is that where NATO is, NATO will stand strong. And I have no doubt that Russia understands that completely, regardless of posturing here and there. But I have difficulty with what the EU was doing in Ukraine. I have difficulty with some of NATO moves in Eastern Europe. And I have no doubt that provocation is a two-way street. And if you don't get a decent dialogue between countries, you're going to run into problems in the long run. And this is where I think we are now. We're in a position where we're formulating strategy, but based on an absence of dialogue about it.
Well, thank you for your comments. Let me just highlight one area where I disagree, and that is that I think that the EU did exactly the right thing and that the IMF did exactly the right thing by reaching out to Ukraine, because Ukraine has been, for quite some time, a very troubled territory. And Ukrainian instability, Ukrainian economic bankruptcy is something that very much harms Western interests. And so I would say there was nothing wrong with the EU reaching out to Ukraine. That doesn't mean that Ukraine should only be part of the West. My view of Ukraine is that it should be a bridge. That's what its role has traditionally been in history, a bridge between two empires, a bridge between Russia and the West. And there's no reason why more cooperation with the EU has to be in competition with more cooperation with Russia. It is Putin who made that decision, because the Eurasian Union is not a free trade union. The Eurasian Union is a preferential trading arrangement, and that is why free trade with the EU is something that threatens Putin.
We're going to have to end it there. It's unfortunate, because I think that the conversation could go on for a lot longer. I said at the outset that Kim Marten was someone who brought together, who was able to bring her deep knowledge and her scholarship to bear on contemporary policy questions in ways that are enlightening, and an all too rare skill and combination of talents. But you really demonstrated that today, leading us in a extremely stimulating and at times spirited and interesting exchange. I want to thank also those of you in the audience for your questions. I thought, you know, we had a wonderful, excellent, wonderful discussion here today. But most of all, I want to thank Kim for the energy and the care that she put into this presentation, and also for helping us, I think, all to leave here with some new ideas and ways of thinking about these issues. We might not have the answers. We certainly don't. But I hope that we can all feel that we have new ways of thinking through issues that are often presented in fairly black and white ways. And we really can ask for nothing more. So for that, for a wonderful presentation, thank you very much on behalf of everyone here, Kimberly Marten.
Thank you. My pleasure.